Welcome and thanks for joining me. My name's Olivia and I'm an accredited nutritionist and dietitian. Today I want to talk to you about fad diets. How many of you scroll your social media and encounter at least one of these influencer types selling you the latest faddy diet and lifestyle plan? And let's face it, some of them can look very convincing and appear to be really healthy and like something we should all be aspiring to. As a nutrition professional, I get asked all the time, what do you think about this diet? Or is this diet healthy? And so I'm here today to give you the pros and cons on some of the more popular diets around just now. I'm going to start with intermittent fasting. Now, this is a tradition dating back centuries that is practiced in many cultures around the world, but has gained popularity for its perceived health benefits and weight loss. While there are lots of variations, the most common two are the 5-2 diet and the 16-8. The 5-2 diet is characterized by 5 days of normal eating and 2 non-consecutive days of restricted intake of approximately 500 calories. Now, when you think that a piece of fruit is approximately 100 calories, that doesn't amount to much across those days. Conversely, the 16-8 form of fasting is 16 hours of fast daily and 8 hours of normal eating during that daily window. There's many reported health benefits, but the most cited are weight management, but more so in women than men, and also it may improve insulin sensitivity, which is good for people with insulin resistance, such as in pre-diabetes, but we're finding that impact more so in men than women. This method has been successful for some people for health and weight management, but the evidence suggests that it's only as effective as a general moderate energy restriction every day. And the risk with this style of eating is the overconsumption of foods in the non-fasting periods, and the potential that sometimes people are choosing unhealthy food choices during their eating hours. Some people also really struggle with the side effects of fasting, which can be dizziness or weakness and headaches, which may mean that people are less active on those days as well. These side effects of the fasting diet are very similar to the symptoms of another popular diet trend, the ketogenic diet. In fact, this diet has its own term, keto flu, for the symptoms of grogginess, muscle weakness, dizziness, and in some people, nausea, vomiting, constipation, or diarrhea. While this might not sound very appealing, this diet has received huge attention for its weight management use, despite this diet actually being used to manage epilepsy. Other names for this diet over history has been the Atkins diet, South Beach diet, the Paleo diet. While they all have subtle differences, ultimately they are all very low carbohydrate diets designed to put the body into ketosis, which causes the body to use fat stores for energy instead of carbohydrate. If we were to rework our public health nutrition images to suit a keto style diet, it would look something like this, with high fat foods, including butter and meats being plentiful, making up the bulk of the diet, and only a small proportion for a limited range of low carbohydrate vegetables, fruits, and alternative dairy sources. Notice there's no grains there at all. While this diet can produce rapid weight loss, this is usually due to the fluid loss that people experience as their stored glucose or carbohydrate is lost in the transition from using carbohydrate as an energy source to fat. In reality, people tend to find it hard to follow this diet in the long term, with the novelty of bacon and eggs for breakfast wearing off quite quickly. And for people with medical conditions such as diabetes, kidney disease, liver disease, or high cholesterol and blood pressure, this diet would not be recommended. The limits of fresh fruit and vegetables and grainy foods also put the individual at a risk of a number of vitamin and mineral deficiencies, hence the keto supplements that are usually sold alongside this diet. In fact, on the original keto diet, the Atkins diet, individuals were recommended to take a multivitamin to stop their hair falling out and to reduce the risk of low mood and depression. Let's move on to the clean eating diet, a craze that has its foundations in healthy eating, but has been elevated to exclusively using fresh and sometimes organic produce, no processed foods, and in some variations has borrowed from the keto style of diet in reducing the type and volume of starchy foods that can be consumed, and also recommending sugar and dairy substitutes and the use of plant-based fats, including the not-so-healthy coconut oils. While this diet, as well as the others discussed, actually promote a lot of the health messages that dietitians and nutritionists would be very supportive of, after all, we could all do with eating less sugar and processed foods, there is a real risk to these diets promoting over-restrictive dietary practices, and for anyone that has a history of eating disorders, these diets can reactivate disordered eating habits. It's important to also realise that these diets are not always what they seem. The current presentation of the clean diet, when evaluated by one of our own academics here at Flinders, found that only about 20% of people engaging with clean eating information were able to follow it regularly. As let's face it, who has time to prepare everything from scratch, or the budget to buy organic or berries out of season? In a further study, when they looked at clean eating recipes, they were analysed and compared to regular recipes for similar items. The clean eating recipes, which often included coconut oil and sugar substitutes, had the same amount of energy, fat, and salt as the regular recipes, therefore demonstrating that the idea of these foods being healthier is misleading. So what is the take home from all of this? Are these diets healthy? Well, yes and no. Some are better than others, and most promote a large intake of fresh fruit and vegetables and reduced reliance on processed and fast foods. However, they're all restrictive and all associated with potential health risks if followed in their extreme forms, mainly due to the undesirable level of food group restriction. While it doesn't sound as new and exciting and won't promise a quick fix, healthy eating can actually incorporate aspects of any of these diets, and a nutrition professional such as a nutritionist or a dietitian can help tailor your own eating to accommodate health goals that you may have, which could include a slightly lower carbohydrate eating plan, or it could include some intermittent fasting, but we would be making sure that your overall diet was healthy and complete for all your nutrient requirements without needing huge amounts of supplements, drinks, or teas to make up for the nutrient shortfalls. We would also be making sure that you had no medical conditions that would make certain changes risky to your overall health. Here at Flinders, our programs are designed to train our graduates to offer realistic and personalized dietary advice. This is just the tip of the iceberg in terms of how we equip our graduates, but everything we do is grounded in evidence and packaged with a client-centered focus, because we understand that one diet does not fit all. Good nutrition is fundamental to a healthy lifestyle. So if you're interested in food, working with people, and the relationship between diet, health, and disease prevention, then a career in nutrition might be for you.